It's Brian Preston, the money guy.
I have to read this because it has the name of our company in it. But actually, why, you know, it's page 49. I love this, Sarah. Quote, economic opportunities continue to abound in this country, yet most Americans are not wealthy. It's easy to blame the so-called inequities in our economy, but it is more about the fact that Americans spend all or most of their income on things that have little or no lasting value, end quote.
I should be like, sick burn.
It is. I mean, but it is. I mean, the simplest stuff. That's why when I read books about habits and other things, it's sometimes the simplest things. And that sentence says it all, and the fact of how do you prioritize and spend your money really does say a lot about it. And here's something I think is unique when we're comparing and contrasting to 1996 and now, and you know, social media. I mean, wow. I mean, we've always had the saying of keeping up with the Joneses, didn't it? That existed back in 1996. But they, you know, nowhere.
The Joneses didn't have Instagram back
exactly.
then.
Exactly. No, they didn't.
So what is, I mean, any thoughts on what happens in modern society now with all these distractions and everything, Sarah, from your research and when you're putting the book together?
Yeah, absolutely. I think you could have a whole show on this one too. You know, the influence now of what other people are doing is always with us. Mm-hmm. So, you know, if you are someone that uses social media a lot, that you're undoubtedly influenced by what you're seeing. There's lots of studies out there already that are starting to look at the influence of constantly looking at what other people are doing and its influence on your own behavior. And we see that in the research we've done. So we know that individuals that are spending time on social media tend to be those that have a harder time ignoring what's going on around them. Mm-hmm. They also tend to be, you know, those that are struggling a little bit when it comes to building wealth. So I think you know, being able to be disciplined and saying, hey, you know, this is something that's out there and people are putting their best foot forward, so I can't get caught up in what's going on there is a real habit to start implementing today if that's something that you're struggling with or you're feeling like you're left out because you weren't included on a vacation or didn't get a new car like this person did. Those are the kinds of things that can be, you know, detrimental to you making good decisions in the future.
Yeah, I mean, it is so powerful. I mean, it is amazing how much influence this stuff has. It's not all rosy. I do want to bring up two things that you brought, but then I want to give some money guy advice to our listeners. Mm. You had talked about healthcare and education. I mean, that there is that those costs are going up significantly.
Yep. Yeah, definitely. I think in particular, we talk about education and even what you were sharing earlier, you know, the idea that you have to go to a traditional four-year school, that you have to follow the same path that other people are. Millionaires Next Door do things differently. I mean, they just always have. And so as education continues to increase, they're going to continue to do things a little differently. It may be, you know, a community college first and then, you know, a state school later once they're able to save up some money, those kinds of things. And so that's, you know, again, just doing things differently is the hallmark of someone that is able to build wealth over time.
Well, I'm always amazed. I mean, I find myself going down crazy dark, not dark, but rabbit holes on YouTube. Dark made me sound like I'm doing something really creepy, but with my kids' filters on there, nothing like that's happening. But it is one of those things. I watched a pullover video. You know, everybody likes watching cop pullover videos. So it's like my weird habit.
Yeah, and, everybody likes doing
and
that.
And one
right?
of them that Me was too. This like sick burn was that there was this attorney that was pulled. He was driving an Uber and he was pulled over. But and then he was an attorney, so he knew his. It was just kind of an interesting thing. But the point of all this, I go way on tangents to say that I'm shocked at how many people are side hustling these days. And didn't your research show that is a pretty common thing?
Definitely. We saw that, you know, again, we didn't ask that specifically in our surveys, but we've seen that. And I think that that's some controversy. I think some individuals would say that those side hustles are because they have to and they can't make ends meet. And that is absolutely the case in a lot of environments, and particularly for individuals that aren't you know, making a certain level of income. But for individuals that are, you know, kind of making an average level of income and really want to ensure that they're kind of doing this faster, they're beginning their own businesses. Again, it's so much easier today to do that. You can compared to 1996. I mean, you can sit in your basement and come up with a business idea and start it in an hour, which now maybe it won't be successful, but you can certainly do it. And so I think that, you know, continuing to plan for the future to make sure that you're secure from an income standpoint, doing something that you love, even if it's on the side and in the evenings, is important.
You know, I'm hearing a common theme come from you, Sarah, and tell me if I'm hearing this correctly, that when it comes to being a millionaire, I think this was your exact word, it's not about being lucky, but I'd even go so far as to say it's about making choices and participating in behaviors that purposefully put you in the direction towards millionaire status. It's not about letting life happen to you and participating passively in life. It's cognitively making some very specific decisions that move you towards that goal. Am I hearing that correctly?
I think that's a great way to put it. I think that, you know, again, being aware of what's going on in your life, whether that's kind of where you're headed in your career or where your household is headed financially, or even kind of the time that you're spending with your family and how that's being allocated. And like you said, making some real decisions about where you're headed and, you know, proactively, you know, creating a plan to achieve the goals that you want to achieve is important.
Well, kind of, I had a whole section of some interesting points I came across when I was going through your whole book, Sarah. But before I kind of, because I obviously need to cherry pick my list, but I wanted to give you the opportunity since you have been engrossed in this material. I mean, what's the biggest, most surprising or interesting things you kind of think that people would be surprised or find solace in, or, you know, get a connection from?
Yeah, you know, I think my background and my research background is in looking at kind of life experiences and kind of the things that impact you even from an early age. And so I think it's important to understand that a lot of millionaires have frugal parents. They have parents that are willing, and some of this comes in the book and some of it's just from research we've been doing lately. They have parents that are engaged in their career choices. They're asking them what they want to do instead of maybe telling them what they should do. They're teaching them good money behaviors, whether that's through showing them, you know, we're going to sit down, we're going to talk about these things. Or they are, you know, they're exhibiting good behaviors. So, you know, when the neighbors have, you know, brand new cars in their driveway, they're not going out the next day and getting something even better. You know,
reaction.
I mean, that sounds silly, but that's kind of what we're seeing. And I think that theme has continued throughout the research, again, started by my father, but continuing today as well.